Who is the one that is watching this video? Who is the one that is taping this video? Is it the dilettante? Is it the academic? Is it this? Is it that? It is the one who realizes and accepts that one must do this. One must take the spiritual path to its conclusion. We have no choice in the matter whatsoever. This is the only attitude that actually works, and this is the attitude of repentance. The repentant mind, the mood of repentance, comes from realizing that we have no choice. We have to do this. It's absolute necessity, absolute necessity. Now, in this video, we're going to do something different that we haven't done before, and there is going to be, I'm going to introduce some graphics. I'm going to comment while the graphics are playing, and you will see it's very beautiful, very sacred graphics. I tried putting music to these graphics, and in experimenting I found it splits my attention. I'm not able to get into this feeling of absolute necessity that I must understand this. It's more like, oh, I'm being entertained, this is nice. So I've realized that the spiritual path transcends. It's an art unto itself. It's an art unto itself. It's the art of necessity. It's the art of absolute necessity. Let's put it that way. Okay? It's beyond the other arts. It really is. It really is. And this is coming from an artist. Okay? A successful artist in a previous life. And I find no matter what music I tried to put to these graphics, which is art in itself, but it's more realism, as you will see, it didn't work. It doesn't work. It's distracting. It doesn't work. We must focus on the art of absolute necessity, the art of absolute necessity, which is this spiritual path that we're taking to its conclusion. And we're getting to the conclusion, and the conclusion is to abide in truth. That is the conclusion. We get glimpses along the way, and then we continue, and the glimpses fade, and we say, what happened to the glimpses? And then we try to get the glimpses back, and they fade again. Very frustrating. But we must, out of necessity, stay on the path, stay working at this out of absolute necessity till its conclusion, which is abiding in truth. Abiding in truth. What is the truth? What is the truth? Is it that there's time, but we're caught up in it, and we need to get less caught up in it, or we need to, there's time, but we need to avoid it, or there's time, we need to know how to manage it better, or, you know, what is the truth? It's none of those. It is the fact that there isn't any time. There's never been even one moment of time. There isn't time right now. It's not that we need to escape time, it's that we need to realize that time never started. So this is a very different realization than trying to escape time. Okay, time has never started and never will start. Well, we think, wait a minute, there's this, you know, incredible universe that's time, right? It says, no, we're imagining this. Our imagination is taking on a play such that it seems as though time is very plausible. It seems as though this is time, but it's not. It's not. What this is a dress rehearsal, a simulation that of our imagination, our mental imagination, that is preparing us, preparing spirit, for time to start, so that when time begins, we'll feel like, oh, this feels familiar. This is pretty familiar. I know how to function in this. Oh yeah, I know how to be a body in a world, in a cosmos, and struggle to survive and have illnesses and all that. I've been dreaming of this, rehearsing in a dream how to do this. This exists, what we call existence, nature, electromagnetic universe, is a dream. It's 100% a dream. And it's like a symbol of time. It's like a symbol of time. It's symbolizing what we believe time will be like. But guess what? There isn't going to be any time. So all this is without any value. There's no value to it whatsoever. So we must continue to take the path out of the art of absolute necessity here to its conclusion. So for that purpose, I've spent yesterday afternoon and evening working on this video, which highlights this statement. I say, I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. In other words, I am preparing you to realize that time is never going to start. The realization that time will never start. I am preparing you for time not to start. Instead of preparing you for time to start, which is what this world, universe is, this is preparation, a dream preparation to try to prepare us for time to start. The great teachers help prepare us for time not to start. Because we're so caught up in believing this is necessary, this dream. I have to have this because how else will I be able to function in time if I'm not ready for it? And then we hear that time will never start. So what we need to do is prepare for time not to start. See? Prepare for time not to start. How is that preparation? So this is the great preparation that we need to be engaged in. Okay? So I am going to click on this video and do some narration over this video. So 3, 2, 1, and let's see if I can get it to go. I'm going to view it on YouTube, which I have on now, and it's trying to get started. Okay, there we go. I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. Okay? I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. Okay? Not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. Okay? This is our little affirmation that we're doing here. Very important affirmation that we need to, out of absolute necessity. The art of absolute necessity brings its own brilliance with it. Okay? It does. It absolutely does. And so we're engaged in this here. And keep that in mind. We're engaged in this different type of brilliance that other art simply doesn't really have. You cannot get it through other art. I am preparing you for time not to start. So here is Jesus, the Mount of Olives by Jerusalem, talking to the apostles and saying, I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. This is what Jesus is all about. He will say, I am preparing you for time not to start. Instead of the set of us, what we've been doing is preparing for time to start. Jesus says, I am preparing you for time not to start. Okay? I am preparing you for time not to start. It's not going to start. It's not going to start. Here he's talking to the Pharisees and Sadducees, and he's explaining to them. He says, hey, why am I here? Well, I am here preparing you for time not to start. It's that simple. I am preparing you for time not to start. There he is at the feast of Matthew in Capernaum, and he's saying to the folks there, I am preparing you for time not to start. That's why I'm here. I'm not here to prepare you for time to start, which is what you think I'm here for. I'm preparing you for time not to start. Okay? So now he's having a talk here in the countryside, and they ask him, why are you here? Why are you here? I'm here. I am here to prepare you for time not to start. This is something that you need help with. This is the spiritual path, is preparation for time not to start. How do you use your moments? How do you use your moments here? We use them to prepare for time not to start. Get used to time not starting, because it's never going to start. It is not going to start. Ever. And so we need to prepare for this fact. This is the one central fact that we must prepare for. And that is, we must prepare you for time not to start. And Jesus is saying, wow, it's hard to get through to you guys, isn't it? I mean, this is really tough. How do I explain to you that time is never going to start? Time is never going to start. Now, whatever Jesus was doing, whatever happened, for sure he was preparing us for time not to start. This is the role of those who realize that time, there's no such thing as time, and there never will be, therefore it will never be starting. We don't need this dream of existence at all. What else can they do that to help us and help us by helping us prepare for time not to start? So we turned from preparing for time to start to preparing for time not to start. That last picture was the resurrection. So I am preparing you for time not to start. Jesus giving a talk by the Sea of Galilee here. And he is basically saying, I am preparing you for time not to start. And everybody is saying, what in the world is he talking about? What in the world is he talking about? And now they're looking up at the cross. This is Jesus looking down from the cross, and everybody's looking up at the cross. And he's saying, they're wondering, why? What happened? What happened? Jesus is saying, hey, I am here to prepare you for time not to start. Okay? I am here to prepare you for time not to start. Walking on the Via Dolorosa, the road of sorrows. And, he's saying, hey, look, folks, look, everything I'm doing, I'm preparing you for time not to start. That is why I am here. And this one, he's before Pilate, I believe. Pontius Pilate says, Pilate says, why are you here? I am preparing you for time not to start. Preparing you for time not to start. And Pilate says, not sure what you're saying. Just like us, you know, but I there's something here. Not sure. Here is in the amount of transfiguration. I am preparing you for time not to start. That's why I came here. That's what the mission is all about. This is what the spiritual path is all about. I am here. I am preparing you for time not to start. It's not going to start. Here's doing a healing or participating in someone recovering from an imagined situation. Remember, all this is simulation. All this is simulation. Our life, our death, our sickness, everything we're doing with time, space, process, and form is a simulation of what we believe time is going to be like once it starts. But it's useless. All this is simply waste, completely idleness, really. It's useless. Time is never going to start. There's no such thing as time. It cannot start. It cannot start. And this is Jesus being brought to the temple just after birth. And he says, hey, folks, hi. I'm here. I'm here to prepare you for time not to start. Okay? And this is, people are saying, wow, this is, here's someone asking him, why are you here? What are you saying? I don't understand. And Jesus will say, I'm preparing you for time not to start. I'm preparing you for time not to start. Okay? Whereas you're preparing for time to start, I'm saying that's futile. It is futile. It is futile. It is futile. I am here to prepare you for time not to start. Talking with, looks like someone like Matthew there, or could be Peter or whatever. I am preparing you for time not to start. Walking through a temple there. I am preparing you for time not to start. This is what he's saying. This is what he's saying. He's looking out over Jerusalem here and saying, to the apostles. Apostles, you want to know why I'm here? I'll tell you why I'm here. I am preparing you for time not to start. You must prepare for time not to start, because you're so ready, trying to get so ready for time to start. You need to use preparation in a different way. Prepare for time not to start. Get used to the idea of time not starting, that you don't need any preparation for time to start. You must get used to essentially no preparation. You don't need any preparation, because time will never start. So you need to use preparation to free yourself from preparation, okay? And here we have, I think it's Zacharias up in a tree as Jesus is walking by, and he says, "Hey, Jesus, why are you here?" And he says, "Hey, Zacharias, I am preparing you for time not to start. That's why I'm here. And I'm very different than most of you. Most of you are going with the simulation of life and death and sickness and all this. And yet here I am preparing you for time not to start. Very different, very different." Okay, and they realize, hey, this guy is he's different, very different. Jesus says, "Of course I am. I'm realize that time doesn't exist, will never start, but God didn't create, cannot just create itself. We cannot change the nature of creation and bring something into it that God did not create. God did not create time, therefore time doesn't exist." So Jesus says, "Don't worry, you're on a stormy sea, but I will help you. I will help you prepare for time not to start." And here's Pilate saying, "Here, you know, ecce homo, see your, you know, here's your man. Look at your man, huh?" And Jesus still said, "Hey, folks, I am still here for the same mission. I am preparing you for time not to start. Preparing you for time not to start." We must drill this into our head. And Jesus says, the folks in the temple here are clearing them out. Says, "Hey, this isn't the place of, this is not the marketplace here. This is very serious. You have this absolute necessity called the spiritual path. Absolute necessity. You cannot get around it, because time will never start. Time will never start. So you must drop this preparation for time to start. It's useless to you. It's absolutely useless to you." Here's some folks again, traveling along the road. Jesus says, "Folks, let me tell you why I'm here. I'm preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. I need to say this over and over and over again, over and over and over again, so that you finally get it. I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. This is my huge proclamation here, folks. This is my gigantic proclamation. I am preparing you for time not to start." Okay? And no matter how you view me, okay, it's still the same. My mission still remains the same. Mission still remains the same. I am preparing you for time not to start. Drill this into your mind. Drill it into your mind. Remember, you're a great artist. We're practicing the art of absolute necessity here. And we're having the supper of absolute necessity. I am preparing you for time not to start. They all want to hear what's your final, this is the last supper. Tell us. Come on, you can tell us why you're here. And he says, "Yeah, I'm preparing you for time not to start." That's the final answer. Final answer. Okay, and he says, "You know, they're just not listening to me so well. But what can I do? I have to keep saying this, even though they don't understand. I have to keep saying this, because this is the only truth we need to hear, is that time will never start. Never start. Never start. Never start. Never start. Never start. This is the truth. This is the truth." And St. Peter turned away from Jesus as he's being led to his crucifixion. And he says, and the lady accused him, "Hey, I know you. You're with him." He said, No. I believe that time will start. I'm prepping for it. I'm just like you. I'm prepping for it." And he says, he denied Jesus, you see, three times. Again, the Pilate presenting Jesus to the crowd says, "Hey, this is the one you want to crucify, huh? You want to crucify the one that comes and tells you that time will never start, okay? The one that came to help you prepare for time not to start, because you're too busy preparing for time to start, right?" Exactly. Exactly. And even here, Jesus is, "I am preparing you for time not to start. I'm preparing you for time not to start." Even though they didn't want to hear it. You know, he says, no, this is an absolute necessity I'm talking about here. Absolute necessity. Even if you want to crucify me, I'm not going to back down and tell you it's not necessary. It is absolute necessity. Here he is, Sermon on the Mount. Sermon on the Mount. Talking about preparing you for time not to start. Preparing you for time not to start. And the folks come around from the Sea of Galilee and says, what's this guy talking about? And again, he's being queried, and he says, are you here for the children? Are you here for to help make life better for children? He says, no, I'm here to help you prepare you for time not to start, because it's not going to start. And you must prepare for this fact. You must prepare. It's not going to ever start. And so you have to put this entire preparation, this dream of preparation, you must set it down. So I'm here to help you realize this, okay, and work on this, work towards this. I am preparing you for time not to start. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Now, he says, wow, this is a tough world, you know, isn't it? I mean, this place is very resistant to this message. This is the heart of preparation for time to start here in this world. This is where you go. This is where the people go to really work on it, you know, intensely. And I'm having a hard time getting these people to understand what I'm talking about here. But I am preparing for you not to start. He's telling Peter, I need you to take this message. This is by the Cove of Parables on the Sea of Galilee. And he's telling Peter, you got to take this message throughout history. Keep, you know, do the best you can. I am preparing you for time not to start. He's talking to a blind man here. He says, blind man, open up your eyes and see. Realize that time will never start. It will never start. It's nothing. It doesn't exist. God did not create it. It doesn't matter if we rehearse for it. Rehearsing for it is not going to cause it to start. Okay? Rehearsing for time is not going to cause it to start. Rehearsal is not causative. A dream of rehearsal for time is not causative. Will never be causative. So I am here to prepare you to realize that dreaming about the start of time, preparing for it, is not causative. Therefore, time is not going to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. Okay, Jesus is doing a lot of healing and bringing his message to this world. Working to get through, saying to the rich man here, hey, rich man, you've got to realize what I have to say. Give up everything and follow me, and don't be a dilettante. Okay, don't think you can buy truth. Okay. You have to take the path out of absolute necessity. You must have this feeling of absolute necessity. I have to do this. I have no choice in it. This is what his words to the rich man. The rich man said, wow, you know, I can't buy it. And Jesus says, no, I can't buy it. I am preparing for time not to start. I am preparing for time not to start. I'm sowing the seeds here. Walking about the world, sowing the seeds, sowing the message that we must prepare for time not to start. Okay, not prepare for time to start, which is what we've been doing. We've been using this world and bodies to prepare for time to start. But you can actually use the world and bodies to prepare for time not to start. You don't have to get rid of the body. You don't have to get rid of the world. Okay, you can go into this non-dual state of mind. You absolutely can. And stay in there. Stay in there. Someone here is saying, you know, we want you out of here. We want time to start. And you're ruining our dream. If we stay in our dream, we won't be able to get time to start. And Jesus says, well, you can do whatever you want, but it's not going to cost time to start. Okay. It is not. So here's someone with the palsy, infirm, and Jesus says, get up and walk. You don't have to continue to pretend that time is going to start, and you don't have to start, keep rehearsing. This is the Samaritan woman at the well, and Jesus is saying, look, I'm here. I'm the one you've been waiting for. I'm the Messiah you've been waiting for, and here's my message. I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. This is my simple message. Take this message. There isn't some other message that I have. Don't wait around for some other message. Don't think that I was just kidding and saying that time is going to start and you need to just wait for time to start, because it isn't going to start. You wait in vain. You wait in vain. If you're waiting for time to start, you wait in vain. Now, this is a dream of what we think time is going to be. It's a dream of what we think time is going to be, but it's only a dream. Time doesn't exist. It has never started. It has never started. It has never started. So, I am here to prepare you for time not to start. This is Jesus' mission then, and it's Jesus' mission now. Jesus' mission continues to this day, continues right now. In fact, more than ever, he's actually here in this world right now, in spirit, asking us to those who are repentant, means they realize the spiritual path is an absolute necessity, to hear his message. Hear his message. So this video is to help get that message out from one of his students who has been listening to him. And he says, I am preparing you for time not to start. I am preparing you for time not to start. And the video decided to stop for some reason here. Maybe it'll jump ahead. Nevertheless, our message, Jesus' message, our message to ourselves, okay, is one and the same. Our message to ourselves, Jesus' message to us, our message to ourselves is exactly the same. It's exactly the same. Exactly the same. It's exactly the same. Okay, we need our eyes to be open. We need our mind to be open. We need to focus on this now. Focus on this. Focus on this. This is the new dispensation. All right, to realize this is what Jesus is really talking about is the new dispensation. Okay, it is the new dispensation. To get this, to get it, finally say, ah, okay. All those parables, etc. Now we can understand, though, exactly what Jesus is saying. He's saying, folks, time is never going to start, no matter how long you keep dreaming this dream. And quote-unquote long, I don't mean time. No matter how many moments you spend continually dreaming this dream of what you believe time will be like, it's never going to be causative. It's never going to cause reality to change. It's never going to force God to start time. And there isn't any intercessor. You can't go to someone like my mother and say, hey, can you intercede? We want time to start. And Jesus is saying it can never start. Can you go intercede with Jesus and tell him to start time for us? I mean, we're tired of waiting for time. You know, we're ready for time. You know, we've rehearsed for so long. Can you get Jesus to start time? And the answer is no, no, and no, and no, and no. Reality is one. Reality cannot be changed. We do not have the power. Jesus doesn't have the power to change reality. Even God doesn't have the power to change reality. God has extended itself as reality, okay? And reality, as it is, there's no time in it, okay? There's no time in it. So Jesus is here. He says, I am preparing you for time not to start. It's not going to start. I'm preparing you for this fact. I'm preparing you for this fact of time not starting. I am preparing you for this fact of time not starting. And indeed, we certainly do need to prepare for this. This is an amazing realization that time is never going to start. And then we say, oh my gosh, well, what do I do with all my valuing? I mean, I've been valuing this simulation of this dream, thinking it's all important, thinking that if I don't value it, I won't get prepared for time, and when it starts, I'll go crazy. My mind will just become completely chaotic. This is the fear that we have. This is the fear that we have. But the good news, the gospel that Jesus brings us, the good news is that it can't start. Time can never start. There is no way that we can ever make it start. There's no way that we can change God's mind. There's no way around this. We don't have any leverage, no matter what we do. And we've tried many, 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 many different things to try and force God to start time. Cannot. Because God created us in absolute freedom. And in absolute freedom, there can't be any time. There's no such thing as time. There are no two moments that are intrinsically bound together at all. Absolute freedom is the very opposite of the notion of intrinsic boundness. Okay, that two moments are somehow intrinsically bound together. That would be time. Okay. Absolute freedom is the antithesis, the opposite of that. It says, not antithesis, it's the opposite. in that there are no two moments bound together intrinsically. They're not bound together. We can keep repeating the same moment over and over and over and over, but that does not cause any moment to be bound. We can repeat the same moment a trillion times, okay? And yet, on the trillionth repetition of a moment, that moment is not in the slightest bit bound to the previous zillion repetitions of the moment. It's still completely free for the very next moment to be something entirely different. There's no carryover effect at all in reality. There's no carryover effect that binds us in our experiencing to whatever we want to experience in this moment. None whatsoever. So, therefore, time doesn't exist. It's not a part of reality. It's not an aspect of reality at all. It doesn't exist at all. It's something we just dreamed up in attempt to try and be greater than God, actually. Our arrogance dreamed it up. We said, no, we want a contest with God. And so reality can't be real right at this moment. So if it's not real, what is it like? Well, it must be bound. It must not be free. Well, that would be time. So we have dreamed up in our imagination this massive simulation. Now, keep in mind that we're told by Jesus that this entire cosmos, electromagnetic cosmos, only represents a fraction of a drop in an ocean of our creativity. A fraction of a drop in the ocean of our creativity, actually. So we can easily dream of a universe, simulate a universe easily, which we have done in an effort to simulate what we think time will be like, so that we can then get this experiencing. How else can we experience time except in a dream format? Like we're dreaming of something that's happening, and we think we're experiencing it, but we're just dreaming that we're experiencing it. But even in this dream, there's no time. There's no time at all, actually. There's only the moment, the isness. That's all there ever is to it. And this is the shock. You see, when we realize this, it's a shock. And that's why Jesus says, I am here to prepare you for time not to start. For the non-starting of time, for the non-beginning of time. I'm here to help you realize that there is no beginning to time. I'm here to help you, I'm here to prepare you to realize that time never begins. It never starts. And so this is what the path is really about, is waking up from this dream and saying, oh my gosh, there actually was never any time at all taking place here. And then we think, oh my gosh, I'm not ready for it then. It's only a dream. Well, we don't need to be ready for it because it's not going to start. It's not going to start. It's not that it has the potential to start. It has zero potential to start. Zero. So we have tried to frighten ourselves in an attempt to keep this dream going so we can hopefully make it causative. We frighten ourselves so severely that we think if we stop this dream, we'll be annihilated. If we stop this dream, we'll have total mental chaos. If we stop this dream, we'll miss out on the new creation of time. We won't be able to dwell in a new kingdom. If we miss this dream, God will be super angry at us. If we drop the dream, God will be super angry at us. You know, all these scare tactics that we have used, none of them is true. None of them is true. And so we need to work through these dreadful fears that we have bullied ourselves, really. Forgive ourselves for bullying ourselves. We've bullied ourselves. And yet we can never bully ourselves into truth, into enlightenment. You cannot. Bullying doesn't work. We can't force ourselves to wake up from this dream. So the path really is about forgiveness. We need to really forgive ourselves from trying this in the first place. Have this kind of... It's an art, the art of necessity, absolute necessity, and nothing else is like it. Okay, you can't compensate for it. You know, you can't say, well, it's like a mother's to a gentleness toward a child, or you know, this or this. Use an analogy. None of those analogies work. None of them work. You can't. The spiritual path is not really analogous to anything else. Only those who have taken it, can understand it. And they cannot impart this understanding to others who have not repented. The only way to get it is to do it. It's the only way to get it. And the only way to do it is to realize it. I got no choice. It's not like I can just keep waiting for time to start and eventually it's going to start. That's never going to happen. So I wait in vain. I wait in vain. I wait in vain. And then the realization, I'm waiting in vain. You know, so I have no choice but to wake up from this dream, to set it down. It's not getting me anywhere. It's not going to be causative. It's much ado about nothing. I have no choice. It's much ado about nothing. This is the truth. It is this world and universe is much ado about nothing. And so we must prepare for this realization. We must prepare for this recognition. Must prepare for this recognition. We must prepare for time not to start. And we must see it. We must see everything like, oh, time isn't here and it's not starting. There's no evidence of having started at all. We must recognize there's no evidence at all that the time has ever started. None. And then abide in this recognition. Abide in this recognition. So when we're abiding in this recognition, we can simply say, I'm just preparing for time not to start. And I must really, really, really prepare for this, for the final realization that this has been nothing but much ado about nothing, this entire dream, and I don't need any preparation at all. Zero. Ultimately, we will even set down preparing for time not to start and then go beyond the whole notion of preparation at all. Reality doesn't require any preparation. But because we believe that our creativity is preparation. Preparation is creativity. We think that's we're so used to this dream. We believe that dreaming, a dream of preparation, is creativity. So we're too frightened to set all preparation down right away, just boom, because we think, well, we might cease to exist, I won't have any more creativity, you know. So intermediate step, instead of preparing for time to start, we prepare for time not to start. Okay, this is what Jesus' message. There's this intermediate step. You don't throw all preparation out the window, because the continuity fear is too extreme. We will think, I have no identity. I have no creativity. I don't, you know, we're afraid to do it. Continuity fear. So we use preparation in a different way. We use preparation. We're preparing for time not to start. And this is a mind blower. You know, I realize it's a mind blower when we take it in. I've been taking it in for the last several days. Obviously, the preparation for time to not to start is going to be different. It will be different. But we can still have bodies and a world present. Okay, they don't have to vanish. We can use it in a different way. We can see the world in a different way. Different perception. Perception is we made up perception too. Perception is part of the dream, actually. And so it's just a dream also. So we can certainly have a different dream of perception. We absolutely can. Reality doesn't use perception at all. It uses direct, total knowing. Okay, which we don't. Perception cannot reach knowing, actually. So we ultimately set the whole dream down of preparation, including perception, ultimately. But we're not after that goal right here. We're after preparing for time not to start. And this preparation will give us a different experiencing. When in the dream that we have to prepare for time to start, we have life, death, you know, aging, growing, aging, insecurity, vulnerability, seasons, changes, stuff seems to happen to us, circumstances, situations, you know, all this kind of vulnerability and feeling that all of this is just, you know, out of our control, it's happening to us. And all these cycles are taking place, all these dynamics of nature are taking place, all this stuff. This is all a dream to prepare us for what we believe time is going to be like. It's a simulation, and we're just saying if there was such a situation, such as moments being bound together, if we weren't free, what would that lack of freedom be like? And so this is our idea of what it would be like. And yet, again, it's only a dream. It's not actually happening to us. We are projecting this as a dream continuously. It's not actually happening to spirit at all. Not at all. Just like a dream isn't actually happening to the dreamer. It's all the stuff in a dream. The dream figures are going through all the stuff, but the dreamer's just, you know, they're sleeping. And none of this stuff is actually happening to the dreamer. It's the same way with spirit. None of this stuff in this universe is actually happening to spirit at all. Just nothing more than a figment of its imagination. And so this is the gospel. This is the good news you get, those who realize that the spiritual path is really the art of absolute necessity. Then you get this information and you say, wow, this is really fabulous. I love this. I never could have got this if I didn't really repent and realize an absolute necessity. I never would have got this. I would have been still playing with this dream of time, still trying to, you know, get a good spot in time, trying to get a front row seat in time, or try to get on the good side of time, try to pray to time, try to worship time, try to ask time for favors. See, we're trying to, for all the stuff, the way we've been relating to God is really we're imagining, how is it going to be like when time starts? What kind of relationship are we going to have, you know? And oh well, we say, well, I mean, we might need to make a god of time and then pray to this god of time and try to get some help, because we're like feel fearful, you know, we feel like vulnerable. Like, so we're going through this imagining this dream of praying to time, praying to, asking time for favors, asking time for this, asking time for that. That too is all part of the dream. God, of course, is it pays no attention to this silliness, and the Holy Spirit, which is the blessing of God upon us, knows not of time. It's free of time. It's not bothered. It's the great master of this silly delusion of time. Okay. So we get help. We get help from the Holy Spirit, from our own inner truth, actually. But it's enough right now to drill this into our minds. Drill this into our minds. I am here to prepare for time not to start. I am here. It's one or the other, right? It's very cut and dry. Now, the trouble we have is we conjure up this in this dream of time. We say, we're feeling like we don't like time. So we say, wow, in this dream of time, we're going to feel like as if we don't want time and we want to get rid of it. But if time is a new reality and we have this great desire to get rid of it, you know, how do we deal with that? If we might be able to succeed in getting rid of it, and then we'll be annihilated. So this is like a really big fear for us. And we've come up with the answer. Hey, we're going to invent some wonderful God, some aspect of God, or maybe some different God. Let's call it a goddess, who comes in and says, hey, everybody, I understand you have this fear of time and dislike of time and you want to get rid of time, but I guess what? I have the remedy for you. And we say, oh, thank you, guys. This is wonderful. This is so different than the God of time, which says you must love time. And we're saying, well, we don't love time so much. He says, I understand. I understand everything about you. I understand everything about your situation. And so here's what we're going to do. We're going to have time, both time and no time. Simultaneously, you're going to have both. you get both, you see? And that's the solution to it. And we say, oh, gosh, thank you, gosh. That eases my mind, you know. So we're working on this in this dream simulation of time. We're working on the potential troubles that we see arising if and when time begins, if and when we lose freedom, absolute freedom, which we never will. We have this. We say this. Oh, we might have a problem. Like we might want to reject time because it's just not what we really want. So we have to bring in this very sympathetic figure. Who says, "Oh, I understand your feelings. Yes, yes. The God of time is harsh. Yes, the God of time is demanding. Yes, I understand that you don't like being bodies. But I can make you happy as a body. There's a way you can be happy as a body. There's a way you can be happy, you know, living with time." And all you have to do is blend time and no time together. Just join them. You know, let's have this beautiful compromise. Let's all just get along. Can't we just all get along here? And let's all learn to be tolerant and peaceful and live together. So this is this goddess ideology of compromise, okay, which is what right now in this dream of simulating what we think time will be like, we're in this phase now where many people, many of us dream figures in the dream, the way it's going now is to turn to the goddess, because we're saying, like, you know, we really don't like time so much. You know, it's we're tired of it. We reached this point towards the end of you know, till towards the year 2000, on this planet, many were really reconsidering this whole notion of this dream, a simulated dream of time, trying to prepare us for time, the start of time. And we were saying, you know, I just can't stand it. I just don't want it. I don't like it. I want to get rid of it. And then, in answer to this, we were thinking, what do we do about this? What do we do about this? Boy, this could be a potential problem once time starts. We gotta figure this problem out ahead of time, you know. So this is what we've been working on, and we've come up with this culture right now, 2015. This is basically our answer in the dream. We figure out this is probably the solution. We need to have a goddess, matriarchal goddess culture that worships the body and tries to make everything really abundant, materialism and happy this way, and mentally, we need to find some way to fuse time and no time. We have both time and no time. We'll please both sides. This is the compromise, the solution. The guy says, don't worry. You have this conflict? No problem. I'll solve the conflict. But please both sides. Okay. And then, you know, this is what we're trying. Now, Jesus and those who are awake and those who have listened to Jesus know that this is impossible. This is impossible. This is ridiculous, and it doesn't work, and it's not needed either, because time will never start. It's a moot point, isn't it? It's a moot point. The idea of, well, what will happen? What happens if time starts and I don't like it? What do I do then? It's a moot point. We don't need to bring the intercessor goddess into the picture and say, you know, I can motivate you to fuse truth and lies, to fuse time and no time. I can motivate you to do that. Don't need it. We don't need anything to happen in this dream, actually. We don't need anything to happen. Okay? There's nothing that needs to happen in this dream whatsoever, because time will never start. So ultimately, this is absolutely much ado about nothing. There's nothing actually consequential that can ever happen in this dream's existence, this simulation of what time might be like. There's nothing that ever has to happen. There's nothing that is truly consequential whatsoever. Birds are running around here. So we continue to talk about Jesus, because Jesus was one that came to this world and challenged us to say, hey, I'm challenging you to change direction, to repent. Take up the cross of absolute necessity. You must realize that this whole simulation for time and trying to work out the problems ahead of time in the simulation is much ado about nothing. It has no consequence. Time isn't ever going to start. Again, we are running the simulation of what we believe time will be like when and if it starts, in order to iron out the potential problems that might arise, because we fear there might be some severe problems that might arise from this, and so we're trying to symbolize them, but try to simulate what these problems might be like, and then work on a simulated resolution for the problem. But it's all still simulation. It's dream simulation. All this is dream simulation, imagination on the part of spirit, mind, and it's of no consequence. It doesn't matter if we come up, isolate some potential problems. It doesn't matter what our solution for those potential problems are going to be. There isn't any time. Therefore, it's never going to start. Therefore, there's never going to be any problems with time. And there's no need for any way to resolve the problems with time. Time is never going to start. This is the essential message. Not only is it going to not start, it doesn't exist. We're free. Our free, absolute perfect freedom is always going to be our perfect freedom. There's not going to be any change in that. We can't change that. Now, I said Jesus is back. I believe this is true. Why do I know this? Because I feel at ease with this. His message. I am here to prepare you for time not to start. And I say, great, thank you. That's exactly what I want. So I have a reason to be aware of it. And others, they say, I don't want to hear that. So they say, I don't want to know he's back. Forget it. I'm just going to ignore it. I'm just going to, what we do here, if we don't want to pay attention to something, we ignore it. So if people don't want to pay attention to this, they'll just ignore it. So most have ignored this fact that I told Jesus if he ever came back, I'd tell the world that he's back. But I tell you, Jesus, I can guarantee you nobody's going to pay attention to it. I'm here in the world. I can do the attitude of the world. I can tell you nobody's going to pay. Almost no one is going to pay any attention to it. And that's exactly what's happened. I told the world nothing. Crickets, 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 crickets. Almost crickets, maybe a few, right? But speaking, and if you want to speak in generalizations, which is very helpful to do so, you can say, this is just crickets. Everybody's saying that when Jesus comes back, they're all going to be some huge celebration, and I don't see any celebration taking place right now. I'm looking around every day. Is there a celebration breaking out somewhere? Am I missing something? And no. I don't see some headlines. Hey, come to the Jesus has returned celebration. Maybe I should start one. But the fact is, I'm already telling the world and crickets. So if you put up a big sign that Jesus has returned, is anyone going to come? No, they'll come to tell you that you're crazy. That's the only reason why they would attend. Say, what are you talking about? If Jesus comes back, I would know about it. Oh, really? Okay. Well, how do you hang out with a friend? I'll tell you what are friends? Friends are those who generally share, they agree on the fundamental basic premise, okay, the purpose. There's some deep agreement about this is our purpose. Now, they may disagree stylistically, but they know that there isn't this vast rift between their basic premises, okay? So, how can you be a friend with Jesus if you have a total rift in your premise? If you believe all this is real and you believe that it's necessary and it's consequential, and that if you believe that time will start and our purpose is to get ready for it, and God has made all this to help us get ready for time starting, if those are your premises, how in the world can you be comfortable with Jesus as a friend when his basic premise is no, time doesn't exist, it will never start, none of this is necessary, it's all totally inconsequential. Those are his basic premises. So how can you be comfortable? You're going to feel like, wait a minute, we're going to get in some argument, nasty argument here. It's very frightening. But whereas with a friend, you feel like you're not going to get in some nasty argument. You're not going to part ways in some horrible, darkness of severe fear and anger. So you feel comfortable. You feel like, I'm just hanging out. It doesn't matter what the friend says. I know where they're basically coming from. So I'm not going to get in some horrible argument. There's not going to be some betrayal taking place here, not some huge deceit taking place here. You feel like, I'm very comfortable. So that's my attitude. That's my attitude. I'm comfortable with the basic premises that Jesus has. So of course I'm going to say, hey, welcome back, welcome back, welcome back. Absolutely. I'm trying to throw a party for you, Jesus, but nobody's attending. Maybe I should try that. Throw a welcome back Jesus party and see if anybody attends. But in my whole 58 years in this world, I've never met anybody really. There might be a few of you out there, right, that are watching these videos who would attend such a party, who really would attend such a party and actually would be welcome Jesus back. Because everybody's, here is expecting Jesus to come back and help them prepare for time, because they're saying, gosh, Jesus, I'm having such a hard time figuring out how to solve these you know, prepare for time and solve these potential problems. And, you know, it's like the God of time. I'm not going to sure how I'm going to be able to relate to God when God's a God of time. And you need to help me with this. And glad you're back to help me with this. And no, that's not Jesus. It's not Jesus at all. They haven't been listening. Because must realize that there isn't any problem with Jesus to help us for, except the continuity problem of fear of setting down all preparation, all simulation, boom, like that. No, let's at least prepare for time not to start. Okay, that's the one problem Jesus will help us with. That's it. Everything else is, again, nothing is consequential in this simulation at all. Doesn't touch reality, doesn't touch spirit, doesn't touch God. No consequence to it. It's non-causative. It's just sheer arrogance. It's non-causative. It doesn't touch anything. How are we doing here? Okay, pretty good. So, that's all. Now, who's comfortable with that? You know, Jesus might just sit there quietly and say, Jesus, why aren't you fixing stuff here? Why aren't you helping us? Why aren't you helping us prepare? We got all these problems. We can't figure out. We're simulating all these problems, and this is going to happen, and this is going to happen. Oh, my God, we're going to have all these political problems. Well, this, how do we solve? How do we bring peace to a world once time starts? We're body in a world. How are we going to make that world nice and happy so we can dwell there and not go into this? The thing we fear most is we fear like we're not going to really like time, not want it, and then we're going to want to set it, get rid of it. And then we're going to have to try to fuse time and no time together. And when we do that, we get this total chaos in our mind. And we're terrified of this, Jesus. So please help us, you know, make this world a nice place. So when time starts, we'll know how to, you know, be happy with time. And we'll figure out how to love time. And we won't want to set it down, you know. And this is what most people are hoping for with Jesus. This is what most people are hoping for. They hope in vain. They wait in vain for such a Jesus. Such a Jesus doesn't exist. Jesus brings truth. Brings truth here. Not illusion. Not fantasy. He's just going to say, folks, don't worry. There isn't any time. There never will be. So, no worries, right? No worries. You don't need to figure out what will happen if you fall out of love with time. It doesn't matter. There's never going to be any time to love in the first place. So it's a moot. It's totally moot. You know, it's just not an issue. Be not concerned about that. Now, some of you might be saying, hey, this is interesting. And in fact, it's more than interesting. It's a necessity to get this. And say, hey, you know, if I get used to this and accept this, and then maybe I can welcome Jesus back. Maybe I can attend the party, the Welcome Back Jesus Party. who's going to attend? Maybe I should throw up a website. The Welcome Back Jesus Party. Everyone is invited to attend. And then see how many people decide to attend. It's a party that you need to quote unquote prepare for. Again, what's the preparation? Prepare for time not to start, because that's Jesus' essential message. Time is never going to start. It's never started. There's not been one instant of time ever. Not one. And there never will be even one instant of time. No exception to this. No exception to this. Nobody, no simulation will ever have the power to create even one instant of time. No matter what the scientists do, no matter what the goddess does, no matter what we try in our simulation or dream, it will never create even one instant of time. Never, ever, ever will it have the tiniest fragment of causation. Never. And then we can hear this and say, yeah. Now the thing is, Jesus embodies this. Reassurance. You know, I can say this stuff, but I don't embody this. And Jesus has the presence of this. It's just like You know, it's just it is, you know, the isness of this, the isness is beyond words. It's absolute knowing this. It's knowing this. I can say this, which is a type of preparation. Okay, so I'm preparing for time not to start. Whereas Jesus knows it. He knows it. And this knowing is like this wow, is a wowness to it. The knowing is a wowness to it. Anyone who here that knows, there's a wowness to it. And he actually steps it down into perceiving it here, to actually appear. If he's going to appear here as in a body, it would be a perceiving that time doesn't start. If he appears to us just in spirit, without a body, then it would be the knowing that is present. He knows there's no such thing as time, and it will never start. And this is a powerful righteousness, you know. That's real righteousness. Which it means to be totally right, you know. This is the righteousness that we need to get used to. I've been working to get used to it, because how else are you going to hang out with the righteous, unless you know at least, you know, you've got to expose yourself to this righteousness, absolutely. And the concepts can only go so far. I'm still looking for some opportunity to you know, be with this righteousness. Whether it, you know, if it comes in dreams, or whether I just have to do it, abide in it myself, I don't know. But we have pictures of saints, we have videos of saints, and then we can talk about this and all. And this is helpful. It is a type of preparation, absolutely. Hopefully, ultimately, we'll get to be in the presence of one who knows, or one who perceives with absolute clarity this truth. There's a physical form, but it will be a perceiving. Jesus tells us that you cannot stay in this world long if you're knowing. If you know the truth, you can easily just out of this world, just like that, in and out. You cannot keep a stable presence here through knowing, as far as in the simulation of form. Because you just drop the whole dream just like that. You have absolutely no need for it whatsoever. None. Absolutely none. So this is a spiritual, this sort of technical issue that Jesus brings up. So if we see someone in the world who is enlightened, they're perceiving, they're seeing that there's absolutely no need to prepare for time. Time is never going to start. There isn't any time present anywhere. They're seeing it. Now, they may have glimpses of knowing. They may go into knowing a little bit and then come out of it. Go into it a little bit and come out of it. Okay, this can happen. It's like going from the bliss into the great bliss, and then back to the bliss, and then the great bliss. This is how it's been explained to me, is the ones who are in bliss are seeing that there isn't any time. There's no need to prepare for time whatsoever. And occasionally, the ones who go into great bliss, that is the knowing, that knowing, which is beyond any notion of preparation, even preparing to know. Okay, not even beyond even preparing to know. Healed perception, perceiving that there is no time, is preparing to know. We're preparing to know. So we have, you know, right now we're preparing for to see, to abide in the awareness that there isn't any time, and time doesn't exist, and doesn't need to, will never start. We don't need the simulation. And then once we abide in it, that abiding is the final step, you might say, of preparing to know. And after that, the knowing is beyond all preparation, all perception entirely. Has no need of it whatsoever. But Jesus says God takes the final step. He says don't concern yourself about it. Don't concern yourself about it. It's not necessary here. Absolutely. But we're going toward healed perception. We are preparing for time to not start. We're preparing for time to not start. We're preparing for time to not begin. Okay. So what is our experiencing going to be when time doesn't start? In other words, what is our experiencing going to be when time doesn't start? When we realize it's not going to start. When we realize time is not going to start, what is our experience going to be? And this is what we have to look forward to here. What is our experience going to be when we realize, oh, time is never going to start? Okay. Bliss. We're going to have bliss. We're going to have peace. We're going to be exalted in righteousness. We're going to just be feel safe and invulnerable, and it's okay because nothing's consequential here. So we're going to be enlightened, essentially. So this is what we need to experience. In preparing for time not to start means we're focusing on this, getting into this preparation of bliss, preparation of abiding in vision of oneness, preparation of abiding in peacefulness. This is preparation, ultimately, for preparing to know. Okay, so it's necessary for us. Again, we're still on the path of necessity here. Okay, still on the path of necessity. We must do this. There's no way around it. And again, it will be the spiritual art. We're spiritual artists. We're artists of spiritual necessity. We're artists of absolute necessity. Spiritual artists of absolute necessity here. So when people ask us, well, how are you going to do this? Well, this question doesn't resonate with us, actually. It's like asking an artist, well, how are you going to, you know, do this? How are you going to compose this, paint this next painting? How are you going to... those paintings that you saw in this video were by... James Tissot, T-I-S-S-O-T, great French painter, and by Carl Bloch, great Danish painter. There might have been a couple others by a few other painters, actually, but most of what you saw there was by those two painters, James Tissot and Carl Bloch. Bloch specialized in tremendously realistic paintings, and Tissot did realistic paintings, but also he tended to capture the context very beautifully of situations with you know, lots of different people and a whole scene, and the overall, you know, expressions of the attitudes, what people were feeling. He was able to portray what they might be thinking or feeling and planning what the actions they might be, you know, ready to take. And so he sort of like a moment in time, he was, quote unquote, in this simulated dream of time, he was able to paint this, you know. So he had a great talent that way. So it's very difficult to know how to help here in this world. Yeah, you know, if you throw a party for Jesus' back party and nobody shows up, how are you helping? How can you help here? This is something I ask every day. Every day I meditate on this, and it's very difficult to come up with anything. Again, if you don't take the spiritual path as absolute necessity, I don't see any way anyone can be really helped. Except in just some diffuse way. I guess a lot of help is just has to be diffuse, and for me it's difficult to understand that this extreme diffuseness of help. You know, it's just completely non-quantified. It seems very non-quantifiable, you know, entirely abstract. Yeah, you know, we're not yet entirely abstract. We're just this, you know, just somehow it diffuses, and somehow it all is helpful in ultimately, yeah. But we want, you know, most of us want to see, you know, if we throw a party for the Welcome Back Jesus party and nobody shows up, we're probably going to feel like, wow, that wasn't very successful. And so I struggle with this, you know. So I tend to do it anyway, just to do it. And maybe in some way that is helpful. It seems like it's better to do it than not do it. Like that kind of thing. Maybe I should do that and start welcome back Jesus parties, you know, and have people attend and I'll give a talk, you know, give a talk and we'll help people focus on what's Jesus's basic, what's his message, what's he about, why is he here, what is his purpose, his mindset, what makes him tick, what's it all about, so that people can start getting clued into this and. Of course, you know, people might hiss and say, wait a minute, that's not my Jesus, you know, you're not talking about my Jesus, what are you talking, you're trying to deceive me, you're not talking about my Jesus is here to do this and this and this and this, this is the Jesus that I want, this is the help that I need in this simulated dream of time to help me deal with the problems of time, I need somebody here who's going to help me deal with these problems, you know, and that's my Jesus, and well, okay, but that's not the Jesus that's come back, that's returned. That's the Jesus that you're still waiting for. I see this in everybody, in those who profess, you know, Christians profess the waiting for Jesus. They're always waiting, you know. They're waiting for their Jesus to come back. The one that's going to help them with what they feel their problems are here, issues of how do I figure out how to deal with the problems of time that may arise. That's what they're waiting for. So they say, well, my Jesus hasn't, you know, I'm still waiting. I'm still going to wait. Not yet. So if you say, well, Jesus is back, they say, well, no, they're going to keep waiting. They say, no, not yet. Maybe they're simulating in this dream of time. What are they going to do if Jesus doesn't come back? What if nobody comes into time and tells them, guess what, everybody? It's all a dream. And so they're simulating that. They're simulating the non-help, help never arriving. They're simulating waiting for help, but it never comes. And this is a way actually to, I think, for people to get used to, like, get disappointed, like, oh, there is no way to escape time. There is no help to escape time. I got to get used to this. And I'm like, you know, feel the disappointment. So they keep waiting. Oh, yes, someone's going to come and help. Someone's going to help, but they never come, never help. And gradually try to, you know, wean you away from the idea that there is any help, you know. So again, all a simulation. Like, what if time started and we wanted to escape it and we asked for help escaping it, but no help ever came, you know. Someone said, I will help you, but they never do. They never do. How are we going to deal with that? How are we going to deal with that disappointment? I've actually been through that. This is what I've been taken through this. It's like terrible. Terrible. Very fascinating, huh? Stuff. So they will keep pretending that no, Jesus is not back, and no, because they're working on hoping that something, help is coming, but it never comes. It just doesn't come, at least not in their lifetime, you know, not in their lifetime. So that's why they were taught, well, you know, the help comes after you die. You die, and then you get the help. Of course, dying is, again, just a simulation of what we think will happen in time, once time starts. And an afterlife also, we think there might, maybe there's an afterlife after, you know, in time, and then maybe we're going to be born again, you know, and et cetera, et cetera. But this is all part of the simulation, folks. It's only a simulation. It's only a simulation. None of this is ever going to happen, actually. Nothing is ever going to happen. For absolutely free. How can anything happen to us that changes our freedom? And if we're still absolutely perfectly free, how can time happen to us? It cannot. So none of this will ever happen to us. So we can change our purpose for this dream and say, hey, let's have a dream of preparing for time not to start. And then Jesus can say, yeah, I'd like to attend that kind of party. You want to have a welcome back Jesus party and that'll be what you're focusing on? Great. But I don't know. I've done so many things in my life like this that are just, you know, quixotic, and people think, like, you know, what are you doing that for? And heresy, nonsense. But I don't know. It's an interesting idea, isn't it? maybe Jesus will attend at a distance, have the party, you know, and he's across the street there, you know, just like a, you know, just like a passerby or somebody, you know, not paying any attention, but just there at a distance. Don't want to get too close, you know, don't want to scare anybody. All this stuff is possible. It's when you're preparing for time not to start, then you have a different outlook about what's possible in this possible here. You have a very different outlook. And I've realized that I got caught up in extreme cleverness of saying, well, maybe, you know, simulate help not coming, and then maybe that, you know, I still got caught up in the preparation for time to start in very advanced ways. So I thought, wow, this is very advanced, but it was just very, very advanced ways to prepare for time not to start. And I was told, once you master these ways, then you're really going to be ready for time to start. And it's very confusing. So the miraculous did not happen the way I wanted it to, because I was still caught up in that, you know, what seemed to be, the logic of arrogance seemed to be very advanced ways to prepare for time to start, ironing out the very, you know, the most difficult problems of that might arise in time. Thinking like, wow, this is really advanced. But gradually I've seen through it and realized, wow, that's all still part of arrogance. That's all still part of the simulation, preparing for time to start. And so when we prepare for time not to start, then possibilities definitely will change. The possibilities, like, wow, now I see what's really possible. Miracles are really possible now. In fact, we should expect them. Jesus gave the world a course in miracles, preparing for miracles, preparing for miracles. Well, when do miracles happen? When we're preparing for time not to start. That's when the miraculous begins to take place. That's when you can see some spiritual teacher just manifest and then de-manifest, and all sorts of miracles can happen. And then you just say, oh, that's just part of preparing for time not to start. This is, I have a new purpose now for this dream. So in a dream, anything can happen, right? Because you were just imagining it. So, sure. And the miraculous can absolutely happen in this dream. Because remember, all these laws of nature are just a simulation of what we think it's going to be like. It's not actually true. This isn't actually happening to us, any of these laws. It's not happening to spirit at all. Spirit's projecting this whole dream. So nothing is really happening. So it's not like you're going against the laws of nature or going, you know, doing this. No, not at all. Jesus said, you want that mountain to move? Pfft, mountain can move. And that's easy, he says. You do anything. It's just, you know, it's a dream. You can, anything's going to. So the miraculous can happen. The miraculous can happen. Once we change our purpose, then we should expect the miraculous is really going to start flowing. And it's a good time in June now for the miraculous to get flowing. Let it be the month of miracles. Let June be the month of miracles. If not preparing for the miracles, we let's focus on the month of miracles. The miraculous needs to start taking place in our lives as we prepare. Now our preparation is not for time to start, but for time not to start. So in this preparation, we allow miracles. We allow miracles. This is part of the whole deal. This is the preparation for time not to start. See, if time started, then how could there be miracles? There couldn't, right? So preparing for time not to start, one of the ways we use this world and this dream is to have miracles happen. This actually helps us prepare for the realization that time will never start. This is part of the preparation we have to do. It's a necessity that we experience miracles. It actually becomes a necessity for us. Absolutely a necessity. You read these stories about these people on the path, you know, with these sacred beings and throughout history, and so many miracles took place for them, right? They you know, they're around these great teachers, and it's just, oh my, just miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. And just like, that's part of the deal. That's a necessity, actually. Miracles become a necessity. It's part of our preparation for time not to start. It's part of the curriculum. Part of the curriculum. So I'm looking forward to those miracles. Don't know what they're going to be, but I'm really amped up and ready for them. And so get into this mode. Get ready for miracles. Get ready for miracles. Now maybe some of you are saying, "Well, just focus on this. It's like a miracle." You know, it's like, "Wow, yeah, there's a lot of wow to it." But we getting ready for miracles is very important. Okay, just, again, I look at it as necessity. It's a necessity. Something I have to do. I have to start experiencing miracles now. There's no way around it. So, if someone just manifests in the street. You know, a great saint just manifests for you. You say, okay, this is part of my new curriculum now. Just take it in stride. Say, okay, great. This is what has to happen for me now. I have to get used to this. And so just take it in that light, you know, that you're still a student. You're still a student. We're still students here. When we're preparing for time not to start, we're still, you know, grinding away as students. And we have classes we have to finish. Okay, and so the miraculous is like a class, it's a curriculum that we have to get used to it. So don't freak out, say, oh my God, so, you know, something appeared, you know, whatever. Just say, okay, this is fine, great, wonderful, this is helping me prepare for time not to start. This is part of the curriculum that I must master this curriculum, so here's something to help me, you know, get used to it. And this is just take it in stride. Whatever happens, take it in stride. Just part of the curriculum that you have to get used to it. Yeah, it's part of your preparation for time not to start. No way around it. Because, of course, in reality, anything can be experienced at any moment. There isn't any time, space, process, or form to interfere at all. So, you know, a miracle, someone just appears in front of you, you know, you just, you know, you say, wow, I mean, what process did you go through to do that? Or, you know, how long did it take you to get here? You know, is this form real? No, see, none of these, it transcends our belief in time, space, process, and form. Which this is only a simulation. It points out, hey, this is only a simulation. This is what we have to realize. It's only a simulation. It's not real. It's a dream. So there aren't any real laws in a dream, are there? There aren't any real laws. We can dream up dream laws. This whole cosmos, electromagnetic cosmos, is a dream with dream laws, okay, that we're holding in place. But none of that is real. So we have to begin realizing we're not really bound by this dream at all. So, like bilocation, trilocation, you could have appearances. A teacher can appear in many places at once. Get used to it. Say, great, this is part of the whole thing of getting used to it. A teacher can drop dead on the spot and start to rot away, and then suddenly they can come back to perfect life, like then not a blemish on them. You know, say, okay, you know, just the play of appearance. It's helped me practice. For time not to start, realizing this is all a simulation. It's not really time starting. It's all a simulation. I don't need it. Time's never going to start. I don't need the simulation. I don't need to keep believing in these laws of nature. I don't need to keep believing in these laws of nature. There aren't any laws of nature. This is a simulation. Millennials, you could call it a matrix, a vast matrix. It's not really being generated by computers, though. It's being generated by spirit and mind. And mind is not a computer. Spirit is not a computer. Sorry to burst that bubble, but it's true. Computers are a simulation, too. These supercomputers are also just a simulation. The Matrix is a simulation. Okay? It's not real. as they say among these great saints, the laws of nature seem to be inoperable around them. Seem to be inoperable. Without them doing anything. It's not like they're doing a bunch of magic, you know, to like somehow, you know, create the illusion. The laws of nature are just simply inoperable in many different, you know, and they don't have to try and, since they're helping us prepare for time not to start, they don't have to overdo it. You know, they don't have to overdo it. Because they're just here to help us prepare. So and we're like nervous. You say, wait a minute, I thought I need this simulation to prepare for time. And if I get off focusing, if I take my focus and attention off of the simulation, I might not be ready for time. I'm not sure how to solve the problems. I need to get used to nature and my dislike of it and learn how to deal with that. Otherwise I might get angry at time, you know, and all that, we have to set it aside and say, oh great, thank you miracle, I'm really very grateful that you've appeared for me to help me with my preparation for time not to start. So really, we're putting the Holy Spirit on the spot, we're putting miracles on the spot, we're putting Jesus on the spot, we're saying, hey, we need miracles now, it's a necessity. So the miracles need to start appearing for us, need to start taking place for us, so we can get used to them. How else can we get used to miracles if they don't happen? We have to have them take place here. It's a course in miracles. Of course it is. literally. You know, all that verbiage in A Course in Miracles is only to get us prepared for the actual experiencing of miracles. That's all it was about. Once you start experiencing, you don't need the verbiage. That's why Journey Beyond Words is the book that Jesus, the commentary, Jesus, his own commentary upon the Course says, look, if you want to boil it down, it's a journey beyond words. You need to get to the point where you're able to accept miracles. It's a necessity to help us prepare for time not to start, which is this realization, time's never going to start. Total realization of that, when we ultimately know it. We have to prepare for knowing this, absolutely knowing it ultimately. So again, we need miracles. We have to have miracles. There's no way around it. And this is, for me, I felt the lack of miracles, and it's like I say, how can I succeed, Jesus? There's no way to succeed if you don't have miracles. You can't succeed. It's just still conceptual. Still verbal, conceptual. It needed to be experiential. Let's see, you get a flat tire, which I did recently, flat tire in the dream, in the simulation. I say, well, you know, I mean, this is preparing for time. Like, what if I'm in time and I get a flat tire? What do I, you know, how do I still love time? Why not just have the flat just, you know, go away like that? It's a miracle. Because other people freak out. Just, hey, wait a minute. I need that flat to prepare. Because what happens if when time starts and I get a flat tire in time? I got to know, you know, how to still love time. So most people are very resistant. They don't want any miracles. Very resistant to it. Even the very idea freaks them out. What? Miracles? Nothing can change the laws of nature. It's impossible. They're inviolate, you know. You cannot violate them in any way, shape, or form. Hello, bird. So you see, when a miracle happens, we don't have to figure out, well, how could that happen in time? That's not the purpose of it. The purpose is to show this is all simulation based on trying to prepare for time. The question is, how could this happen in time is a ridiculous question. Time's never going to start, so how can you even ask such a question of how is this going to happen in time? It's not. Nothing's going to happen in time. There isn't anything that's ever going to take place in time. There isn't anything. There's nothing that's ever going to take place in time. That's the answer. How is this going to happen in time? Well, there's nothing that's ever going to take place in time. And as to how is this going to take place in this dream simulation? Well, simply because I choose it to. I'm preparing for time not to start. That's how it happened. How it happened through my own, you know, artistry of, you know, the art of spiritual necessity is what, how it happened. That's the answer. That's the answer. Spirit is, you know, working. Holy Spirit's working with the simulation to help me. That's all. That's how it happened. And again, there aren't any laws at work here. How can there be real laws in a dream? There isn't. You know, of course, most people, you take the simulations, you know, with utmost seriousness, thinking, my God, if we don't do this, we'll never be ready when time starts. We won't have a clue. So we all agree to believe that there are these laws, that these laws are real. It's just a collective agreement to keep pretending, you know, as if. But they're not. There's no reality to the simulation at all. So, focus on miracles. Focus on miracles. What else is there to focus on? I keep praying for miracles. I have to keep praying and keep realizing the necessity of miracles. And maybe a welcome back Jesus party needs to get going. Get that underway. I don't know. Maybe that'll be a miracle how that happens. You get funding. We'll get crowdsource funding for a welcome back Jesus celebration. Something like that. I don't know. I have no idea. It's a nice thought, though. It's a good idea. And people say, "Whoa, where is he? Where is he? Where is he? Where is he? I want to interrogate him. I want to, you know, help me. Hey, Jesus, I need to help me with this. I have a flat tire." That would be interesting, wouldn't it? That might throw a little bit of a curveball to the world, right? People start attending these Welcome Back Jesus celebrations, and politicians start saying, "Hey, wait a minute, I'm running this campaign here. I want everybody to pay attention to my campaign when I get up there on a stage and say how I'm going to solve the problems of this and this and that." And some people are attending a Welcome Back Jesus celebration. What the heck is that? I need to pass a law outlawing Welcome Back Jesus celebrations. It might throw a curveball into society in general, huh? It's just fun to think about, isn't it? It's great to think about it. Consider it. Consider it done, you know, consider it done. The artist will say, what can I do? What can I do? What kind of music can I compose? What kind of dance can I compose? What kind of paintings and pictures? Blah, 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 blah. No art. Forget about art. Forget about art. Jesus is not coming back for artists, for art, to inspire art. Not coming back to inspire art. Coming back to inspire the art of the spiritual path of absolute necessity. That's the art. And that's sitting quietly. Managing your success. Managing your success. If you're attending a Welcome Back Jesus celebration, you know, that's huge success for you. So you need to manage that success. Full stop on the wow. Be quiet. Be quiet. Be quiet. Don't worry. Don't think about art. You know, art. In Don't think about what do I need to do, you know, what flowers. No, I had this, I was in church last Sunday, and suddenly this idea hit me, you know, that it's like, I said, you know, if something happens, I just had this sort of basic parameter of like, no flowers, no music. Because I see in church, you know, that the focus on flowers and music and everything else, you know, is just like blah, you know. It's like a plane made out of stone, you know, expecting it to fly. We have this stone plane, you know, there on the altar, and we're all waiting for it to fly. You know, it's like, yeah, we just wait long enough. Maybe if I die, it'll fly. If I die, it'll fly. Maybe that's maybe a way to encapsulate, you know, encapsulate it. If I die, it will fly. You know, there's these statues of Jesus and Mary and Joseph, and there's all this various stuff, and there's celebrations, and there's flowers, beautiful flowers everywhere, and much of the service has music. That's just pomp and circumstances to keep us fired up. You know, if I die, it'll fly. I'm just thinking, you know, I'm not sure this stone plane is going to fly. You're thinking about that. And so it's, let's sing this wonderful song to the plane, you know, the stone plane. Oh, okay. We get up, and that's fun singing a song, but then you sit down and you still think, huh, still don't think it's going to fly, you know. So I thought, hey, you know, what if we had a situation where, you know, one of the stipulations was no music and no flowers. No music and no flowers. And this the Holy Spirit gave me this. It's always the Holy Spirit, like, what if? It's like, I feel like, what if we made a stipulation? What if there's a stipulation for some, you know, for some sort of worship situation? What if there's a stipulation? No music and no flowers. And I said, yes. I would go for that. Because I've been through both. I've been through the music and the flower thing, the whole thing, to the max. And I can tell you, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. The stone plane doesn't fly. And I'm not going to die to try to make the stone plane fly. I'll tell you that. So let's take everybody off the hook. No flowers, no music. No flowers, no music. Leave your flowers outside. No flowers, no music. Don't bring flowers, and we're not going to be singing any songs. You don't have to sing any songs. No music. No instruments. No singing. No music. None. I said, that's cool. I love that. That's awesome. That is awesome. Just sit quietly. Just sit quietly. Because you must absorb. You must absorb the impact of the situation. And it's bigger. It's bigger than art. It's the ultimate art, the spiritual art of absolute necessity. Trumps all other art, completely trumps it. And no dance, okay? No music, no flowers, no music, no dance. None of this stuff. I'd attend that. That would be great. That would be great. No pressure. No pressure for that. See, no pressure. No, you know, maybe no questions. You don't have to ask questions. You just come and sit quietly. You come and sit quietly. Now, this is what we're supposed to do in church, but they throw so much music into it now, and you know, so many beautiful flowers and plants everywhere and stuff. You're just like, what is this? Come to a garden party or something. So no plants, no flowers, no singing, no music. Now Protestants have tried to do this. They try, but you know, they kind of do a lot of singing. A lot of them. There's no singing, no singing, no singing, no singing, no singing, no flowers, no statues, flowers, plants, singing, dancing. Merrymaking, eating, all that stuff. Just none of that. Bring your presence and just sit. Your presence is there. The fact that your presence is there, that is the awesomeness of it. That is the high art, the spiritual art of absolute necessity. You are a living art. You're a performance artist of the highest standard. Performance artist of, you're here. You're here at the party. You're here at the celebration. That's spiritual performance art, Okay, so you need to be a master of spiritual performance art out of absolute necessity. And the way to do that, no flowers, no dancing, no singing, no food, no none of this. Okay, leave all that foolishness. Leave it at home. Set it by the wayside. You won't miss it. Interesting. I said, I knew Jesus was returning, and the goddess told me she was going to help me prepare for that. How did she help me prepare for that? Music, 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 singing, 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 flowers, 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 food, 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 dancing, 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 all of this stuff. She, you know, plants, plants, plants. She wanted this huge presentation of all this stuff. What does all that stuff do? It's extraordinarily distracting. Is what you want to avoid, actually. But here I went through all this preparation, becoming expert at decorations. Oh, beautiful flower decorations. I can, maybe I'll do a video. Well, maybe not, you know. But now I know none of that is appropriate. It's not appropriate. It's not appropriate. Forget about the decorations. Don't need them. So oftentimes I had my set very sparse, you know, very stark. And then, you know, I say, well, you know, I'm trying to get people ready for this. So, you know, maybe I'll have a flower here or a plant here or something. That's okay. But maybe it's time to get rid of it all. No. It's important to understand this. So, Jesus has a message, and what is that message? I'm here to help you prepare for time not to start. I am helping you prepare for time not to start. Why are you here, Jesus? I'm here to help you prepare for time not to start. Okay, this is very profound. Very profound. I am here to help you prepare for time not to start. So Jesus is very profound. In fact, it's the height. It is the ultimate expansion. It is the greatness of profundity. This is the greatest profundity. And you need to, you know, really be present for that. How's the best way to be present? Just sit quietly. That's the best way to be present for this profundity. The goddess, you know, that will tell you all sorts of stuff that you want to hear. You know, like, I'm back too, and I'll help you. I help you prepare for Jesus, and you can come to my parties, and I'll help you prepare, and blah 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 blah. No, that's all distraction away from the profundity, and keeping you engrossed in trying to prepare for time to start. Okay. Jesus is back to help us prepare for time not to start. To turn our attention to. Preparing for time not to start. Prepare 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 for time not to start. Because the truth is, time will never start. So this is a path of absolute necessity that we're engaged in here. So how are we doing here? One hitting the 144, so 147. Yeah. Okay. Great. 44 is a wonderful time to stop this video. Thanks for watching. It's been quite fun, right? Okay, very great. You never know what's next here, right? You never know what's next. Prepare for miracles. Very great. That's it.